Who are these people? We should have just turned it off.
Oh, we could have turned off the ringers.
We could have, exactly.
We're so stupid.
It's so retro.
He's great, though. I got pulled out of Hunger Games a few times, moments where he's talking.
Then he just sort of does this while he's talking. I go, wait, he's doing Larry Flynt. And then I realize, oh, wait, he's just doing Woody Harrelson. Okay.
This was an obvious choice for a subject for a movie.
Funny. Yeah.
I mean, no, it was when we stumbled upon it, but it took us 11 years to get this movie made. So obviously a lot of other people thought it wasn't an obvious choice to get made.
So was it, did you start with the velvet painting and then move on to the big eyes?
Did you go through all the painters
that people don't expect to be really great painters?
No, I mean, the origin of this was...
I could run and get the prop.
That's funny. We were working on a...
Are you a painting with you?
Where we discovered it.
Yeah, exactly. We unmic ourselves. We were working on a science fiction movie at the time that took the place on another planet. And it was about Earth junk that lands on another planet and kind of infects that culture. And so we were looking at... Scott was looking at a book called, The Encyclopedia of Bad Taste?
Yeah. And it's 300 pages of kitsch.
Right.
And, you know, so it's just, oh, funny disco outfit from the 70s. Oh, old sugar cereal from the 60s. Old crappy sitcoms. And then one page was those big-eyed paintings by the Keanes. And it had a two-page article about Margaret and Walter. And it sort of gave just the quick greatest hits. And I was just completely astonished by this.
Yeah.
But it gave the story of...
A bit of it. It included the trial, which made you say, oh, wow, that's really fascinating. Now, I, apart from this, I was really good friends with a rock and roll guy named Matthew Sweet. He did an album called Girlfriend, which is actually one of the great albums. But he is a massive collector of the Keens. And like in the early days of the internet, like the early days of eBay, he was fascinated by them. So he would kind of buy every painting that came up. And those days, you could buy them for nothing. And so he amassed this gigantic collection. So once we started...
You couldn't walk across his house.
Yeah, it was like big-eyed hoarders.
Just stacks.
Yeah.
Stacks of Keens and stacks of all the knockoffs.
Yeah. And so once we decided we wanted to do it...
That's a full house.
Yeah. He became... our go-to guy. So we wound up doing research for about a year, just like going to the library and doing all kinds of...
No, not for a year.
A long time.
We researched for a few months.
Okay, fine.
And then we tracked down Margaret.
So was that, I mean, was there a, did you find the hook, was the hook the trial right away?
No. I mean, we were coming into it kind of calculated, which was we had just had a bad experience, which was we had written this big opus about the Marx Brothers. Mm-hmm. And we had a writing directing deal at a big studio, and everyone loved the script, and there was no way to make it without spending a fortune. And it was a lot of brothers.
Yeah, it's New York kind of thing. You're getting on trains, you're going to vaudeville places.
It's
you're
vaudeville, going to it's town. Los Angeles, it's yeah. New York, and it's this theater, now it's that theater. Mm-hmm. And there was no way to make the art house version of that movie.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so it sort of collapsed under its own weight. And we were really bummed out by that. And so we were kind of looking for a small, intimate project we could do that was one of our kind of stories. Mm-hmm. And so when we sort of started researching the Keens, we were thinking, ooh, this is a one we can just throw together really fast. This is back in 2003.
Yeah.
Because she's a great part, he's a great part. A lot of the scenes are in the painting room. Mm-hmm. It's contained. It doesn't have a lot of scope to it. We can just bang this one out, get two great actors, and go shoot it.
So let me stop you before you go on, just because I'm not. I just want to finish the thought because I love the Marx Brothers movie.
Yeah.
What gets that movie made? What did you think was going to get that movie made?
When Man on the Moon, before Man on the Moon came out, and uh-huh. So it was one of those things where like Universal was happy, like that was going to be a gigantic hit, and so it was like, let's do another biography of a comedian, of classic comedians with Scott and Larry.
Right.
And when Man on the Moon underperformed, it was sort of it didn't matter what the script was at that point; it was kind of like put on the back burner. And so we wound up getting a lot of good actors interested in that, but it always there'd be like, who's playing Chico?
Yeah, I mean, we'd get a giant actor for Groucho, but then like, yeah, but who's Harpo?
Yeah, and so it wound up being that thing. And once again, it's an epic. Here's the thing: we tend to write movies.
So you need four giant actors, or three giant actors, or
well, there's five brothers technically, but
and
Gummo leads the actually.
Gummo and Zeppo are great parts in the movie. Yeah. But I will say this:
Zeppo's the guy who wins Best Supporting Actor.
The Zeppo.
No, because he's
Zeppo's frustrated. Because here's the thing: Zeppo is much younger than the other four guys. He doesn't even, he's not even part of the act. Gummo quits the act. Mom grabs Zeppo out of juvenile hall. Hmm. Says, you're getting on a train tomorrow. We need you in the act. He says, I don't want to be the stupid act, Mom. She says, you're doing it. It's the family business. He shows up, and he's a funny guy. He says, all right, where are my jokes? They go, you don't get jokes. You're doing Gummo's part. Right. Gummo's the straight man. He says, I don't want to be a straight man. Well, shut up and do it. And that was his job for decades. And so he's like really frustrated. And then one night, Groucho gets sick and has to go to the hospital with appendicitis. So they go, who's the understudy? There is an understudy. Zeppo goes, I know the lines. They go, fine. Zeppo puts on the grease paint, goes on stage, and he kills. The audience doesn't know it's not Groucho.
Right.
Hmm.
And everyone realizes Zeppo is as good as Groucho. Groucho hears about this, checks himself out of the hospital, and says, I'm better. And so Zeppo just like carries the weight of the world around on him. So that's why he ends up quitting the act after the first five films, because it's just this existential hell he's in, which everyone says, oh, that worthless fourth Marx brother. But he's not allowed to ever do anything.
Hmm.
But I will say this. That it's,
this is the Shemp of...
There, exactly. There, I sold Zeppo. Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. It's
I feel an Oscar coming for somebody.
The only biopic that we've written that's sort of a great man biopic. And we've always tried to stay
away
from
those.
They deserve
a movie.
They deserve a movie. There's something great about the Marx Brothers.
But it's great men.
Yes.
Yes.
But it, but, yes. But it sort of broke our rules. We'd never write movies that are 3 hours long.
They are already, you know, in the history books.
Yeah. We write movies about like the fringy outcasts and try to make a case for them. I think that's where we do really, really well. And with the Marx Brothers, we sort of made a more traditional biopic. And I think that definitely we said after that, when that didn't get made, we'll never do that again.
So you do Fatty Arbuckle and not Laura
Correct.
Hardy.
Correct.
If
Correct.
You were going to do that.
I was trying to think of a more obscure fat person.
Ben Turpin. Exactly. Instead of W.C. Fields.
Exactly.
They did a lot of W.C. Fields movies, it feels like. Anyway.
Well, they had horrible W.C. Fields and Me.
Yeah. Yeah. With the great Rod Steiger.
Who, exactly.
I think one of his last roles was for Antonio Banderas, and he's playing a judge in the 50s, and he was wearing his Indian beads that he liked to wear, and he apparently wouldn't take them off. Here he is, a judge in the 1950s in the Deep South with Indian beads.
Oh, wow.
Hanging out of us. Anyway.
Actually, we got to work with the great Rod Steiger on Mars Attacks.
That's, right. That's true. And he was great at that.
He was fantastic in that movie.
Yeah. That movie's got a lot of things. I think people forget how much fun that movie is.
Yeah.
Because it's really...
There's a lot of fun stuff.
And how much stuff people actually still steal from it. They're like iconic moments in that movie that I think...
Really?
Filmmakers are still kind of like grabbing moments from that. Yeah,
interesting.
You know, Ack, Ack, Ack. I mean, we don't get credit on that movie, but Ack, Ack, Ack was actually the that was all us. That
actually doing the voices? Or?
Well, no, that, yeah, there was a weird thing where...
you wrote Ack, Ack, Ack?
Yeah, when the script was presented to us, the Martians wouldn't speak. You know, they would be like, the Martian commander yells at... But there wasn't any dialogue.
It was in scene description.
Right.
And you're sort of trying to write a comedy scene and get rhythm to it, and there's mm-hmm. no rhythm because it's you know, Pierce Brosnan's character talks, and then Martian Commander. Pierce Brosnan, Martian Commander. Well, there's no sense of pacing to that. You need bam, boom, bam, boom, boom. Just so you can sort of get through the rhythms of the comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And so we sort of needed placeholder dialogue. And so I just started typing ACK, ACK, ACK over and over. And if it's, you know, angry, it'd be ACK, ACK, capital letters, exclamation point. Or if he's thinking ACK dot dot dot, yeah.
Oh, someone's my! Really trying,
you guys
to
are really.
You've got three numbers, but it's not quite.
Apparently, they brought the
police. Should partner. I just wait for this to stop?
Do you want to grab it or
no.
make sure who it is? Or
no.
Okay.
And so what's funny is that the finish the story though. You know,
can the viewer put up with this?
Can the world put up?
What was funny is that we didn't know Tim was just going to take that and use it. So it wasn't until we saw the film that all of a sudden we saw that the guys were saying ack, ack, ack.
Ack, ack,
and
ack, ack, ack,
ack. Wrote seven ack, 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 they did seven ack, ack, ack.
They took it very literally.
Yeah.
And sometimes when the commander would do a tirade, it would be just a big block of like 50 ack, ack, acks, and they're all in there.
Yeah.
That's so great. We'll get back to the start of this movie, but right. Is that the thing with Tim in general? Is he reverent about the
Tim
words
on the
page?
Tim has been amazing for us, because Tim actually, Ed Wood, shot our very first draft.
Hmm.
There was not a second draft of Ed Wood. There were a couple cuts, But when we gave Tim our first draft of Ed Wood, he's like, I'm making this. I don't have any notes. I don't want to do a development thing with it. I don't want to, like, you know, make the studios come in and say, oh, can Ed Wood make a good movie now or something? You know, he's like, I just believe in what it is. And he did basically the same thing with Big Eyes. He kind of shot what we wrote. And once again, there are sometimes things lifted for production manager kind of reasons and stuff like that. But he shoots, but the great thing about Tim, though, he turns it into Tim Burton movie. Right. It's not like he's just, like, doing what we tell him to do. He brings that his Tim Burton thing to what we do, and he likes what we write.
But does he, like, encourage improv on dialogue and stuff like that?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Which is different than Milos. Milos was the other director that we really worked with quite a bit, and he would encourage. He loved to bring outside input, you know, and so the scenes would all stay the same, but he would shoot them, but he would allow them to go off and come back.
So it's 2003. You think you have an easy task ahead of you.
Right.
Yes.
With this project.
Right.
And you were wrong.
Well, we were very wrong. We did a few months of research. We met Margaret. She was very skittish at first. Apparently, a few years before this, some other Hollywood people had tracked her down, and they had wanted to option her rights for a movie, and so they got her to write them a check.
Whoa.
Yeah. So Margaret's very trusting. And so her rep was a little nervous, like, I don't know about Hollywood people. And so we had to win him over, and then we had to win her over.
Also, it's very important, like, she's still nervous after all this time that people still think Walter is the painter. So, because people, she has a gallery in San Francisco, and people do come into the gallery saying, oh, we want a Walter Keane painting, because Walter was a big front man.
And so she
wanted to know that we weren't going to do a he said, she said kind of thing, we really spent a lot of time convincing her that we really truly believed in her story, and we were telling it from her point of view. Also, she's Jehovah's Witness, which we work into the film too, and she wanted to know that that would be included in the film, and that we weren't going to make fun of it, and that we had initially hadn't intended on using it, but it was kind of fun to embrace it, which we thought, like, it was a great positive thing in her life, and why not just use it? It's really what made her decide to come out and tell the truth. So, and also, it's so unusual to us that then we like to embrace the unusual. So, like, when you in the middle of the movie, when you look out she looks out the window and she sees two women coming to knock on her door, I think a lot of people in the audience are like, where is this thing going?
Yeah, definitely.
We realized years later that we actually had religious conversion scenes in Ed Wood, Matthew, and Larry Flynt.
Yeah.
And the fact that there's now one in this one is just ridiculous. Now, this is the most sincere of them all.
What's funny is when we were writing those scenes, I was driving to work one day, and I saw a couple really well-dressed people walking through my neighborhood with, like, suitcases, and I was like, I think they're Jehovah's Witness. And so I pulled my car over, and I was like, do you guys have some literature? And they'd never had an incoming. They were, like, so happy, like, oh my God, yes, yes. I was like, do you have any more?
Yeah, exactly.
I was like, exactly. Give me everything you had.
My sister used to have a housekeeper who was Jehovah's Witness, and she would try. It was a very Jewish household. It was the kosher. My sister keeps kosher and all that. And she would try, like, every, like, 2 months, there'd be, like, an effort. Like, maybe you should take a look at, okay. She'd give up, but it was always challenging. It actually is funny that you guys, this whole thing of her still people still believing it, because you kind of think that's an internet phenomenon.
Well, no.
That people don't get the news about the change in the story.
Right. Well, no, it seems stupid. Maybe now that our film exists, but, you know, even to go back 11 years, 2003, it was still kind of confusing. Because Walter had kept putting out his own propaganda until he died.
Okay.
I mean, who cares what the judge said in Honolulu?
Right.
Walter kept giving interviews saying, my crazy ex-wife thinks she's the painter. Walter didn't really care what the verdict was.
Right.
And Walter likes to give press conferences, and Margaret is more retiring, and she just prefers to stay home and paint.
Mm.
And so Walter kept putting out the disinformation campaign, you know, until he dropped dead. And so our friend Matthew, the collector, who really, he knew the goods more than anybody, he went and tracked down Walter when Walter was still alive, because even Matthew was still not quite clear. And so when Margaret sort of said this to us, it seemed so odd, because we had just immersed ourselves in months of research. But even after we gave her the first draft of our script, and we were really nervous what her reaction would be, I mean, she had a very strange reaction, which was, oh yeah, you boys did a really nice job. That's fine. But are people going to think Walter's the painter?
Hmm.
And you've seen the movie. There's... nothing in the movie that indicates Walter is the painter.
No, quite the opposite. Yeah.
But Margaret had been so beaten down by all these years of abuse that she could read that into the text and think that somehow people are going to take that from the movie.
Also, what people forget is that when Walter was the front man, that's really when the Keens were in their heyday. That was like when they were like the biggest selling art in the world. And when the trial happened, people had moved on. So when they were actually fighting about the who was the real author, it wasn't on the front page of the paper. It was on page 40 of the paper. And it was a bit of like, you know those people who made that art that you no longer pay attention to? Well, they're fighting about it for some reason.
Well, he's kind of the major, amazing marketer. I mean, he does get that credit.
Yeah. He's a genius.
I know. It'd be like, you know, if Peter Max's wife showed up today.
But that's the thing. You are correct. Because Margaret goes out of her way to say that, you know, look, she would still be in a park. You know, no one would have really bought her paintings without Walter's marketing. And right. That Walter was a genius at marketing. He just wasn't an artist. He wasn't the painter, and that's really what it came down to.
But he was the first guy to say, let's make cheap reproductions and sell it everywhere.
Right.
So you guys were on that tip from the first draft.
Yes.
What do you mean?
On this, like, the specifics of, okay, we're on Margaret's team, or we believe Margaret's.
I mean, there really wasn't much more. I mean,
we made a determination after reading all the material, which was that Walter is the great flashy part. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's very much like our other guys. He like, you know, like Larry Flynt, let's say. He's a guy who likes to get up on a soapbox with a bunch of microphones and give a speech to a crowd of people.
He's not afraid about using his name in a third person.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Nothing makes him happier than just a big block of speech. But Margaret was the one with the character journey. And we made this decision once we sort of looked at the material for a while, which was she had to be the protagonist, which was a big challenge because she's so quiet. And so we're sort of committing ourselves to saying, okay, the guy who has all the dialogue in every scene isn't actually the star of the movie. He's the antagonist. Mm-hmm. And so we were committing to her point of view. Once you commit to her point of view, she's the painter. There's really no other way to slice it up.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But there was no question, when you did some research.
Oh, none whatsoever.
It was all clear to
you.
No. Walter never showed up with another painting.
Walter never produced another painting. Right.
I mean, I'll tell you a great story that Matthew told us was that when he met Walter, that he was like, Walter, I'm fully prepared to believe your story, but the problem is like Margaret still puts out paintings. You don't put any paintings, and he's like, I put paintings all the time. What are you talking about? I have a painting. Look here, I've got a painting here from
1983.
Okay, 1983. What I don't remember. What the numbers changed.
Well, they get divorced in 65.
Right. All right, fine. No, the eight is a three, isn't it? Or no, I'm not sure. Well, you tell the story then. If you're gonna,
which one are you actually?
It doesn't work if it's 88. The story doesn't want to hold together.
Anyway, what happens is
you wrote the movie. He didn't really write the movie.
Exactly. You'll see the story will fall apart at the punchline.
No, 88. Fine, I'll do the 88.
They got divorced in 65.
I'm not gonna. But the number's not right. The number's not right.
All right, do the story of 88 and see what happens.
Fine, 80. Oh, you're right. You're right. I'm sorry. You totally
I'm trying to help you.
It's fine. What is it?
Totally I said correct. 83.
83. Fine, 83. It's 83.
Your Honor.
Anyway, to make a long story short.
Make a short story long.
Exactly. Walter won a lot of money for the painting, and Matthew's like, I can't pay that. And so Matthew goes back to his hotel room, and there's already a message from Walter saying, I'll take $500. And so Matthew drives back and gets the painting, and he gets it, and he's like, oh my God, this is proof that Walter's really still painting. It's a Keane from the 80s. And about 6 months later, Matthew was just like, Matthew also collects memorabilia and all that kind of stuff. And so he was looking at a bunch of old Keane things, and he saw like a picture from the early 60s, and in the deep background of Walter's apartment is he sees his painting. He's like, holy shit, what's going on there? So Matthew goes over to the painting and looks at the date, and he takes like a little like penknife and he flicks off the date, and like, you know, the eight becomes a three. And
the top of the eight falls off.
He literally just taken paper white and did it. And so that sort of inspired us to write the scene that's in the film. I don't want to give that away.
Spoiler alert.
No spoiler. Exactly.
So you wrote her, you wrote this, and it was a script pretty much
Script is pretty much exactly what it is. I mean, it, still, we over time as we tried to make the movie.
I mean, the script that she saw. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, our original draft, like we always do, we vomited out way too much and we waste too much of our own time. So we wrote about 170 pages was our first version.
But we cut all that out.
That's right? Got stuff. Oh, that's got a whole sequence with Tom Wolfe.
Yes.
That's got the Danny Houston character shows up at the Honolulu trial and testifies, and then he melts down on the witness stand. It's got lots of goodies.
We write long, and then we in internally, and then we cut things down.
Because we love all the research, and we find so much fun stuff. So right. In that first pass, we're trying to cram it all in. You know, and then at some point reality sets in, and you know, first we'll like cheat the margins. But if you think you're directing the movie yourself, you're only cheating yourself if you cheat the margins, because you still have to like roll film through the camera with a crew. Once we got it down to about maybe 130 pages, we showed it to Margaret, and it's a little shorter the final film, but the script never really changed that much in the ensuing 7 or 8 years.
But I will say that's one of the things I think that makes our scripts work is that we initially have that long version. And so as we start chopping it all down, every word has to fight for an existence. If you are literally cutting, 40, 50 pages out of a draft, it's like, we are working on like, how can we make this sentence three words less?
Right.
How can we, there's that speech, that's a good line. We'll cut the scene, we'll put that line in a different scene.
Like on Twitter.
Yeah, it's like that a bit. But it's like hopefully the cream
haiku.
Cream rises to the top.
So was there more Danny in the movie?
There was more of everything.
Before? Yeah.
He kind of disappears a little bit in the third act, and this one, he comes back at the end.
He disappears because she moves to Hawaii.
Yeah, yeah.
It might be fun for us just to go look at that very first draft, because those are the only two things that pop in my head, but I know there's another 50 minutes of material.
The screenplay is being published in book form, and it's December 16th is coming out, and there are a bunch of scenes in the book that aren't in the film,
God, so you can read the longer version. I'm trying to remember what's in the super long version.
It's like the Life magazine came to live with them for a little while.
What was Tom Wolfe
doing? Tom Wolfe is really interesting. Tom Wolfe, when Walter was...
when he gets it wrong, you can fix
exactly.
it.
Exactly. When Walter was putting out those coffee table books...
I'll just sit here.
He needed someone to write an introduction. Uh-huh. And Tom Wolfe was a young writer at the time. And he hired Tom Wolfe to do
allegedly.
Yes. Well,
we don't want you to get sued.
Yes.
So it wasn't... Did Tom Wolfe did not sign it?
No, put Eric Schneider's is the name.
It's fantastic. Any of you people can go find a copy of Tomorrow's Masters, the Walter Keane published book from 1964. The introduction is so fantastic and funny and postmodern. It's like a 10-page parody of fawning art criticism. If the author had this PhD in art history and was convinced that Walter Keane, Michelangelo and Gauguin were all equals.
Yeah, exactly.
It's so crazy. And then once Margaret pulls aside and said, Tom Wolfe actually wrote it, it all made sense.
Right.
Because you realize that Tom Wolfe was mocking Walter, but Walter didn't realize it. He thought he was just being praised.
Hmm.
And then Walter took all the clever sound bites within this prose, and then he used them for the next 40 years.
Right.
Every time he'd give an interview, he would be parodying
quote himself.
All this turn of phrase that Wolfe had written, right. Allegedly.
Right. And Wolfe later wrote a book called With the Painted Word that...
kind of deconstructs modern art.
Right. And we always feel like this was like a test run.
It was his first draft.
Yeah, first draft.
Yeah, we would love somebody to go find Tom Wolfe.
We wrote Tom Wolfe a letter hoping he would respond to us, but he didn't respond to us.
You should have sent somebody in a white suit.
Exactly.
He's still doing that?
Oh, I think so.
Why
white
not?
Pajamas. No.
If it works.
I don't know. Go to brown or something. Just like a change of...
David Byrne still walks around in a big suit.
He's doing completely different music with a suit.
I bought 10 of them. I can't get rid of them.
So you thought you were going to direct this yourselves?
Yes. Well, yeah. We spent a long time trying to direct a movie. It almost came together in like 2007. I got the dates wrong all in my head now. In 2007, but the financial crash happened, and then the backer bowed out. We put it together again with Reese Witherspoon, and she got pregnant, and we lost our dates, and it was a bit of a disaster. But how can you not be happy for Reese having a baby? So we wished her well. And
yay, Reese!
Yay, she having a baby.
But during all this time, we scouted Portland, and then we scouted Salt Lake City, and then we had a new line producer in Salt Lake City and a new schedule and a new budget. And each time you move to a new city, you need new locations, and then you're only able to fake so much of San Francisco and Hawaii in different ways in different cities. Mm. And so then each one would then become a different jigsaw puzzle. Oh, I guess we're going to have to do 5 days in San Francisco in this version. Yeah, but if you shoot in New Orleans in another version we did, oh, you only need 2 days in San Francisco. And then we had the version in Buenos Aires.
Really?
Buenos Aires was the most perfect version.
The locations were fantastic. Yeah. The problem was that every one of the day players talked like Chico Marx.
Are there tax credits in Buenos Aires? Or is just one guy?
In that year, there was a guy who didn't quite pan through, who had a dollars to pesos were really good that week, and they have really good crews down there because if you want to shoot a commercial in New York City in December, you can't. But if you go to Buenos Aires, Southern Hemisphere, it doubles.
Yeah.
For North American cities,
so the crews are great there. Huh.
But that version fell apart.
I will say this: all these things falling apart. The smartest thing we ever did was that we never sold the script. We never we never signed away the rights to it. So when it all fell apart, it always we could grab it from the ashes. And that wound up being a little bit of a curse because we blew a lot of our career trying to reassemble this movie over and over again. It kind of hurt us.
Nobody
a while.
Was paying us, and it was all just time coming out of
yeah.
You guys were like pockets. A little bit pregnant.
Yes. We joke. We're like, we made ourselves pregnant. Wow, we're dumb.
Yeah.
So when did Tim come along?
What happened was...
Wandering in the street.
2009, after two or three versions had fallen apart, we knew Tim was a big fan of Margaret, and he had commissioned some Margaret paintings. And so we shot him a letter saying, can you help us out, bud? Can we... put your name on the movie as producer, presenter, whatever makes you happy, just to help us with the financing. Mm-hmm. And he said, yeah, of course.
Yeah, he was fantastic.
And then, and then we continued the constant hustle of actors and actresses. And sometimes if there was an actor we wanted to track down and they were Europe-based, we would hit up Tim saying, could you take her out, for lunch and try to talk to her about playing Margaret. He'd say sure, and so he would help us when we hit him up. Mm-hmm. So he was always sort of just floating in the periphery.
And then right around Django Unchained,
almost 2 years ago.
Yeah, we got a call from a junior agent working with Christoph and saying, "Oh, what do you guys think of Christoph Waltz?" And we're like, "Christoph Waltz, that sounds kind of cool because." Walter has those speeches, and we know from those Tarantino movies, Waltz can do those speeches.
And Walter is very, very charming, but there's an air of malevolence running under it all. Walter is very bright.
So we thought it was pretty interesting, and we looked at each other, and we also knew at the time that Tim was looking for a smaller movie to do. And because we were actually talking to him about a different project,
I think we wanted to believe this.
There was a Russ Meyer thing we were playing with doing with him. And,
oh, that's true. That's
yeah.
True.
So we knew there might be a slide. Like he didn't after Dark Shadows, he wanted to do something to go back to making a real movie. And so we kind of looked at each other and said, well, what if we asked him to switch places? And and so we threw it out. Oh, first of all, back up a little bit. We threw the idea of Christoph Waltz at him, and he was like, that's fantastic. I'm on the whole Oscar circuit with him right now. I'll corner him. I'll try to get it. And we just saw this enthusiasm from him.
I mean, like, we sent the email, and 3 days later, he was meeting with Christoph. I mean, it was really startling to us.
Right.
Tim usually doesn't like jump that fast.
Yeah, he doesn't.
And so he was really hustling. He's like, I met with him. It was great. Next week, I'm going to see him in LA again. And we're like, oh my God, he's just like so pumped about this.
Yeah.
So then we sort of said, you know what? Maybe we can pull a victory out of this because there is this black cloud that floats over this project.
Right.
And we keep sinking so much time into it, and we never have anything to show for it.
Also, here's the thing, we really believed in the story, and for 10 years, we just really wanted the story to be told.
Also, Margaret was getting really old.
Yeah, that's true. We started when she was in her 70s, now she's in her 80s.
I mean, so not crying in your beer over this.
Oh, no. But here's the weird thing, when we went to Tim, we said, like, look, we're asking you to do this, but don't. We didn't tell our agents. We didn't tell our fellow producers.
We didn't tell anybody.
We're like, because
we were really
want,
sneaky.
Because we didn't want, if Tim said no, we didn't want everyone to say, oh, Scott and Larry no longer want to direct this. So let's get somebody else. We want, if Tim said yes, he was the only guy you know we were going to go to. And Tim said, are you sure? I don't want you guys to be like bitter about this later. You know, and then we're like, no. We trust you. The whole Ed Wood experience, like where you shot our first drive, it was like an amazing experience for us. And that movie changed our lives.
Miloš's format, the version would be very different. No.
And so Tim said yes, and then he met with Christoph, and Christoph said, "Oh, well, you know, I'll read it after I get the Oscars."
I'm very busy this week.
But then he went back to the hotel room and read it, and agreed to do it. And then 2 days later, he won the Oscar. I think 3 days later, we got Amy Adams, and the Weinsteins jumped in. And within the next couple months, we were in pre-production and we were shooting the movie. So we always joke that for a movie that took 11 years, it came together really quickly.
So yeah. Was there a conversation with Amy, or is it just that was she was like...
Amy had known the project from when we
had
were.
Submitted it to Amy years earlier. And, and I mean, all the talent agents at the big agencies, I mean, to their credit, were always giant fans of the script. And maybe it helped make us deluded over the years in that we got lots of encouragement. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't even like these... agents were necessarily at our agency.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We would have incoming calls from agents at other agencies throwing big actors and big actresses at us saying, oh, she's going to be in town this week. We would love you to meet with her.
Right.
And so, mm-hmm. you know, Amy was one of those people, you know, that we were always chasing. And so she knew the project. And Amy, to her credit, like when actors get to a certain level, they always have a bit of a make me an offer thing that they do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they want to be able to say no. And they, and when they get to a certain level, they don't want to put their neck out because they don't want to get rejected. And their people always protect them. They don't want their client to get rejected because then their client will leave them. And Amy, God bless her, she wrote Tim a letter.
Right.
She basically heard the movie was coming together and she said, you know what, I really identify with this character. I love this project. I love your work. I would love to play Margaret Keane.
Right.
Tim got the letter. And we had just met with Tim, and we were sort of talking about like our two or three best choices. And he got this letter. He said, "She's the one."
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you say? We know she's great.
Right.
And once you get that letter, how do you say no to that?
And she was a new mother, and she has in this relationship with a painter, with an artist, and so she knew roughly how to paint, and it was great. And we, I mean, whatever.
She's kind of going through this transformative period after having her kid.
Yeah, correct.
She really, I mean, American Hustle was also a big push in a different direction for her. And she seemed to be anxious. And this, I think, you know, amazingly, it's a lot closer than I think American Hustle would be to what you'd expect from Amy. But this is a very different role than anything she's done.
This is a very hard role to pull off.
Because any big star.
It's very easy to make that character a doormat. And she does not. And it's like, you know, that was the movie was in post-production for a long time because of the dilemma that Scott was talking about. The fact that the guy who has all the lines is not the protagonist. So you could play scenes, you could cut them in many different ways where you could just, how much of the movie can you play on just Margaret's face?
You have to treat it like a silent movie.
Yeah.
And I mean, she's, you know, she's Lillian Gish.
The more passion of Joan of Arc. Mm-hmm. You know, Lily is a woman's face, and you look at her face, and she's reacting to...
But she can't be as big as a silent movie. That's the thing. It's like it's a very subtle performance for something that's also, you know, all that in contained motion.
Mm-hmm. Correct. And she does so much of just like, you know, you can tell she's in love with this guy. She's afraid of this guy. She doesn't know what to do. She's, you know, protective of her daughter. But it's all just coming from her eyes.
Yeah. No, I think that's one of the things that's great about the movie is that it's so... It'd be so easy to make it broader and to go, you know, take another step in whatever direction. And every time it gets close to that point where it becomes melodrama or a movie about a woman in trouble or whatever it might be, it doesn't.
Yeah, well, thank you for saying that because so many people have said over the years, like, how come there's not a plate smashing scene?
Well,
it would be in the normal studio version of this movie. Mm-hmm. And we always resisted that. Margaret Keane was not a person who had a plate smashing scene.
I mean, the movie does not have the scene where she does this. It's not in there.
Right. But I think we did in a certain way embrace the melodrama a bit. I mean, we always felt like this was our Doug Sirk movie, and you know,
is like a '50s woman's picture.
I would take the Weinstein logo off and put like Universal International, you know, because it really has that feeling. And Tim definitely embraced that kind of look too.
But yes, it's also kind of post-feminist.
Totally.
I mean, it's very modern for a movie.
Here's sort of like in terms of like how screenwriting and physical production kind of intersect is. It was really important to us to frame Margaret in the, from our perspective, in the world of a 50s suburban housewife. so the audience would have that idea in their head that this is what she's trying to fight her way out of, mm-hmm. this way of thinking. And the only way to do that, at least is the only clever thing we could think of, was to have a shot of 50 suburbia, and then Margaret drives away. And I mean, you know, the expression is, you know, in production is, come on guys, it's an eighth of a page, you're killing me.
Right.
Which means you're basically asking the crew to go build a block of 1950 suburbia for a scene that's 8 seconds long.
Mm-hmm.
But we had to have it, because for us there was no other way of sort of framing Margaret that way. And then we could sort of shape the movie saying, all right, she's starting coming out of the world of 50s women, and she's going to end the movie late 60s, early 70s as women's lib is just coming in. And we're not even saying that Margaret is even aware of this going on around her, but we think it's really interesting to sort of like put her journey against what was happening, you know, in a larger country.
And she's so not a woman's libber. She's really is
right.
Correct.
And for a lot of the movie, she's almost unaware of the problems of her own life, or of the situations she's enabling.
Well, that's the thing. I think that's a key phrase there, the situation she's enabling, that she's not a victim in the sense that, like, you know, she agreed to this bargain.
Walter is not locking her in from the outside.
Yeah.
She's allowing him to have her lock it from the inside.
Yeah. So she's aware that she's a part of the lie. We always joked that we used to compare it like to Watergate, where those guys were like, you know, the cover up was worse than the crime, where they were just sort of like, you know, once they start saying that Walter's a painter, there's no way she can back out, because when she initially agreed to do it, when she had it was paintings in the bottom of a bar,
yeah,
and
just had to sell somebody.
Yeah, she didn't know it was going to become the biggest selling art in America, and so Walter is the villain, but everything Walter promises comes true.
But her commitment to art also from the very beginning is all whole there.
Well, that, yes. And I think that's why she... And I think that's what got her through it all, is the fact that it just allowed her to do paint every day.
It's what she's happiest doing, is just being alone with the paint.
Yeah. And the daughter is, I think, also another critical piece of it.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Who is, you know, again, pretty subtle through much of the movie.
And the importance of the daughter, Jane... only came out of our meeting with Margaret. We did not go into that first meeting in 2003 with our research having any idea of this. But then when Margaret started talking about the situation that there's three of them living in the house, and then we're saying, well, wait, we're trying to understand this, Margaret. Can you kind of explain that? Did Jane know? She says, well, I expect that she knew, but I would tell her that Walter was a painter. And I asked Margaret, I said, but Jane knew you were lying. She said, yes. Jane knew I was lying to her, and that's my biggest regret.
Mm. Right.
And so it became so tragic that there was really only one person in the world that Margaret was close to, and that person knew Margaret was lying to her for 10 years.
Yeah.
Mm.
But, you know, it was the elephant in the room.
Yeah. But without her, you almost can imagine Walter putting her in a box somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
Oh, yeah.
Making her disappear completely. Yeah. And her be almost willing to go.
Right. She almost disappears. Yeah. I mean, even just in the way the film is now. I mean, she just like she, you know, she's so isolated. She's you know, particularly when they move out of North Beach, and it's like now they're in the country, and she's just like locked in this country house with no friends, and she's, you know,
Walter is. I mean, this is all from stuff she told us. Walter had said, "You can't have friends."
Yeah.
You can't have people come over. They might see the paintings.
Right. Because, I mean, that's where the Kristen Ritter character came from. Because we asked her, like, well, what about your friends? Certainly your friends knew that. And she's like, well, I had a lot of friends in the beginning. But then I wasn't comfortable lying to them. So I wouldn't invite them over. And then, you know, maybe one person would come by and Walter would say, why is she here? Whatever. And so she just became so isolated that she had no one to turn to.
And that scene at the house with Kristen and Christoph is really scary.
Yes, it is.
I mean, it's like a horror movie for a minute like, whoa, okay.
That's funny.
Yeah. But that's the great. I mean, that the tonally, the movie is remarkable. I mean, it's keeping being able to maintain that tone without ever falling over the edge is just it's a high wire act.
We like to do that. I mean, it's dangerous because we like to really mix tones, and so we go from like comedic stuff to very serious stuff to, you know, almost tearjerker kind of stuff to once again back to comedy. And I think the two directors that we work with the most, both Milos and Tim, I think the reasons we like them so much is that they both aren't afraid of mixing jokes and tragedy in the same scene.
I might have misread that scene myself because I find the fight between Kristen and Walter to be hilarious. But I think I'm the only person in the world who finds it funny, because I think most people are with you and they just find it kind of chilling and unpleasant.
It's really
I think the fight itself is funny, and that the where it fits into their lives is horrifying. I mean, I think it's, I think it works both ways.
Well, I think the scene of them sitting in the living room all just quiet, that's chilling.
But I mean, there's that sense of it being. I mean,
but it is interesting. You talk about
she's closer to who he is than his wife is. Oh, Margaret
totally.
Is.
Totally. Mm-hmm. She's got his number.
He knows.
She's got his number.
They both know. Yeah.
It's funny you talk about a horror film. I mean, Tim talking to Tim. Tim, in terms of color schemes and things like this, we always talk about Mario Bava, the Italian horror master, because Tim worshipped Bava, and so Bava and Hitchcock were certainly things in the back of Tim's mind, particularly in that North Beach section.
Well, that house is spectacular.
Yeah.
Just the architecture, I don't know where
that was so hard to get, because once again, in all our scoutings, it was so hard to find that sort of mid-century modern house in places that aren't Southern California or Northern California.
We were obsessed with the mid-century modern, because it represented, for early mid-60s, it meant I've made money.
Right.
I made money on the West Coast. I'm happening. And then also the architecture, it has a lot of glass. And I just thought it was so exciting, the idea of Margaret as a caged bird.
Right.
And that she's in this beautiful, fabulous home, and you see all those beautiful gardens and swimming pools shimmering outside, but she's not of it.
Right.
There's a piece of glass holding her in. And I thought just like the metaphor was so great.
And which is also great that Lana Del Rey picked up on all that stuff, and so her songs, so you actually talked about a bird in a cage and things like that. So.
It became this just comical
pursuit.
Again, self-destructive. Okay, we're shooting the movie in Buenos Aires now. We need a mid-century modern house.
Can't find it.
And then you start, and that list just starts like collapsing upon itself. Oh, and it has to have a swimming pool. Because it's Northern California. It's California. It's California in the 60s. It's a swimming pool. And then they would take you to a house. We found you, sir, we found the perfect house. And you get to this mid-century modern house with an indoor swimming pool.
Right.
And you go, no, because people in California don't have indoor swimming pools.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw, I mean Vancouver and New Orleans. And, you know, we kept seeing these nice houses with indoor pools. And it was a miracle that they found this house in Vancouver,
right? Mm-hmm.
That could double for a California house.
Because actually, you know, it's funny, that house isn't really that big.
No, it's not.
But just the way that glass in the pool, and the way
and those big pieces of wood,
they're fantastic. You know,
it's got the great angles.
And also
to
the way they
lit, like a
they,
slave ship.
They lit it at night with all the reflections off the water. It just makes it seem like that lush mansion.
Yeah, I mean, Tim shot it really well because that was not a big house.
Right.
So how long did you end up shooting?
Yeah, 39 days, all in.
So short for Tim.
I think you have to go back to TV for this budget and this.
What's crazy is if you watch the movie, which is a very San Francisco-y movie, we were only there for 2.5 days.
Yeah.
The rest is Vancouver or a few shots, sort of CG shots, combining pieces of San Francisco in the actors walking around Vancouver.
Schwartzman in Vancouver or San Francisco?
Oh, he's Vancouver.
He's Vancouver, yeah. I mean, Ed Wood.
He brings San Francisco to Vancouver.
Ed Wood, 20 years ago, had more money and almost twice as many shooting days.
Yeah,
it was crazy.
Yeah.
So, what does it feel like now that it's coming out? Is it after you've given so many forms of birth?
Yes,
to this piece.
It's funny. It's very satisfying. Once again, it hasn't come out yet. So
something bad could happen.
Something bad, exactly.
Like it always does.
Yeah. So we, I'm gonna wait till Christmas Day to actually break a smile, I think.
Whatever. Go stand in the back of the room on Christmas Day.
Oh, absolutely. Or? We always do that.
You do that every.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
Great. That's what we make it for.
I drive around a bit.
No, I mean, we're movie fans. That's what, you know, I mean, we're not, you know, I always say that when people, young guys say, like, what should I, what, you know, how do I break in? We always say, write a movie that if you open the newspaper on Friday and you saw the ad, you'd be like, holy shit, I want to see that movie. You know, write that movie you want to see. And so I think, you know, particularly on these bio movies, we're writing the movies we want to see. So we get very excited about the release.
It's in a family event?
We're having a cool thing with the Cine Family. We're doing a Cinematheque event tonight.
Cinematheque event.
Because I'm on the board of the Cine Family, and I do all these events at the Cinematheque. So I'm
sort of straddle both sides of the street there.
I go all
as long as there's some cine involved.
Exactly.
Happy, but that seems like a kind of amazing phenomenon there, the Cine Family Fest.
Yes, it's a very special place.
Very intimate, very, right. Like everybody.
They've done a really amazing job, because once again, I work at all these revival places in town, and I do these events. What Cine Family has that the other guys don't have is that they've managed to attract young people and get young people really excited about cinema, and also women. You know, the young girls show up at Cine Family, and they you know, and they love it. And
when girls show up.
Yeah, exactly. Other guys show up.
But you're saying the Egyptian doesn't get girls?
I'm saying yes. I'm saying that when I'm doing an evening.
Yeah, he's shaking his head.
No, it doesn't. And I step off stage, and those guys come over with their packs of things to sign. It's a different crowd at the place. I'm not knocking. I love movie nerds. Give me movie nerds. I am a movie nerd.
But you'll be signing some boobs at the Cine Family.
Yeah, Cine Family is different. It's a different crowd.
And so it's an exciting moment, but you still have that, always have that fear hanging over your head until opening weekend is over?
It's like, I mean, particularly this one, so much work. You want it to be well received, you want people to go to the movie and to like it.
Right.
And to enjoy it.
Absolutely.
So success of the success this team is not enough?
For this movie, it's all enough. The fact that the movie got made after all this time.
Yeah, we're probably over the hurdle.
Yeah, that for us, this is all gravy right now.
It can't go straight to DVD, right?
We are so proud of it, and I think it's good. So we're happy that we have another good movie, and it's so hard these days to make a good movie. And so
we're just making a movie.
It's so hard to make a movie.
Yeah. So we're just very proud, and you know, this with Tim and Amy and Christoph and the Weinsteins have been, you know, they really are starting to push right now, and so we're really happy.
Yeah, I mean, and we can kind of, you know, look back at our filmography, and there is sort of like a big hole for the last 7 years, because what were we doing? We were trying to make Big Eyes.
Right.
And so it's nice that it actually got made, and we can sort of resume doing other things again.
Right.
So you're not bringing back the Marx Brothers?
No, we're not bringing back the Marx Brothers.
If you've got 4 stars and $60 million, you got my number.
Well, Clint Eastwood, if he finds it in a drawer somewhere.
There you go, maybe.
Pull it out and...
Well, next thing we're doing, it's a crazy, super ambitious thing. We're doing a 10-hour miniseries based on the O.J. Simpson trial.
I'm laughing already.
No, yeah.
Is it of comedy?
It has a lot of black comedy in it.
It's a bit, like the Larry Flynt kind of tone.
Yeah, it is a big sort of. It's a big like Altman-esque portrait of Los Angeles.
Wow.
You know, and it's about race relations and the LAPD and, you know, and the lawyers, and it's just a big portrait of a city.
And you have a backer already, I assume.
Oh, it's FX.
Yeah, it's FX, supposed to be shooting in April.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
So it's all written already.
About half of it's written. Yeah.
And are you guys going to direct some episodes?
Probably not. I don't think so. We're just television.
They talk about it. I don't know.
Where are they?
Ryan Murphy's going to direct the first few.
Right.
Okay. And did he? Is he involved with developing the material?
He came on after we wrote the scripts.
Right. But we're going to do it as the first season of American Crime Story, which is going to be kind of interesting. It's going to allow us that anytime there's a kind of an interesting true crime thing, we can kind of plotted into this.
So Woody is Chris Darden, and Matthew is OJ, and you're
exactly, exactly. Yeah,
should be interesting. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right.
I think this phone call is the one we have to stop.
I know. It's so funny.